pleased to introduce Susan Damaris. Since 2013, Susan has directed state government affairs for the National Alzheimer's Association. In California, the association is organized under two regions with 21 local offices serving individuals and families. As a registered lobbyist in Sacramento, Susan advocates for legislative, budget, and regulatory changes at the state capitol on behalf of the 2.3 million Californians directly impacted by Alzheimer's disease. At the state level, the Alzheimer's Association has secured key legislative victories in dementia training, physician education, and Alzheimer's research, raising more than $26 million through the Voluntary Tax Checkoff Fund. The Alzheimer's Association developed California's State Plan for Alzheimer's Disease, an action plan for 2011 to 2021 under the Schwarzenegger and Brown administrations, and the organization looks forward to collaborating with the Newsom administration on the Alzheimer's Prevention and Preparedness Task Force under the leadership of former First Lady Maria Shriver. Prior to joining the Alzheimer's Association, Susan led government and community relations for UC Davis Health System and the University of California Office of the President. A graduate of CSU Chico, Susan started her career working for the U.S. Congress and the California State Assembly. Please welcome Susan Damaris.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for that nice introduction, and a special thanks to Pauline Martinez and the committee for organizing this wonderful event. This is, I just want to take it in. It can be lonely and discouraging in Sacramento advocating for Alzheimer's disease, so I'm going to take you all back with me to fight for the budget through June 15th, because I know you're out there. The senior rally met every year in Sacramento. There's something called the senior rally, where advocacy groups representing seniors gather on the lawn. And I was on a panel earlier this week, and each of us were asked to give one word. And the first person representing Governor Newsom said optimism. And I share his optimism. In May of 2019, to see all of you here, to hear from Dr. Oldham, thank you so much for your presentation and for being such a wonderful partner and really embodying the potential of public health to partner and link and share resources and collaborate. Such a great example of what's possible in public health. And now I get to figure out So going back, so the last slide was really great, but I don't know how to go backwards. We're not going backwards. That's my word. So working in Sacramento with the governor and the legislature and bringing public health to the fore, something that I personally really like about public health is it is solution-oriented. So we saw that in Dr. Oldham's slides. There were lots of next steps, action steps, things you can do, small things, big things. And that's the nature of advocacy, too, to be solution-oriented. We often rely on this quote here. I think there's no better expert than the former Surgeon General for the United States to talk about this epidemic and this crisis. And it's one that often is overlooked because many people living with Alzheimer's disease are living in skilled nursing or assisted living communities. They're living at home. There's a lot of isolation. There's been a lot of research in the last 18 months or so about social isolation. So it's not as evident and seen. So we use quotes like this to remind people that experts recognize this as an epidemic. So I'm going back a few years. The two data points that we hang our hats on are the Healthy People 2020 goals. You might know next year is 2020. So how's California doing on these two goals? I can tell you they show up in a few reports and some websites, but there has not been any activity at the highest levels to achieve just these two goals. And for other chronic conditions, the Healthy People 2020 goals, some of them have 20 goals. We have just two, and there's not been a lot of activity, but you've heard these themes emerge this morning. The number of people who are not aware of the diagnosis. We can measure that. We know that less than half of people have been diagnosed, and even fewer are aware of their diagnosis. What this means when somebody arrives at the hospital through the emergency room and the team isn't aware of the full picture, we can't provide whole person care when there's key information missing. The second goal is to reduce the proportion of preventable hospitalizations. Individuals with Alzheimer's disease are among the highest users of hospital services, the highest cost services. And we know in California, for the most recent year where the data was collected, we have close to 1 million ER visits a year. It was just over 900,000 ER visits for persons with dementia. By contrast, the opioid crisis, which is significant, and I'm not undervaluing that, there were about 8,000 ER visits. And we hear a lot more about the opioid crisis in the news and as an epidemic. So you've heard there's the three-part test for public health. I'm going to come at it from a California perspective, what we work with our legislators and the governor on. This number, 2.2, is now 2.3 million. Those of us who work in this field are constantly updating our materials and slides because the bar graphs keep going up, the numbers keep rising. This is not static. We use the number 2.3 million now to include the 670,000 Californians who are affected by the disease, as well as the 1.6 million family caregivers, because Alzheimer's is absolutely a family and community disease. We talk about ways to intervene. Often legislators, clinicians will say, well, what can you really do? There's still a very strong sense of futility with Alzheimer's disease because today it is always fatal. And there are minimal treatment options. But something as simple as screening could be an intervention. Detection could be an intervention. A diagnosis could be an intervention. These are basic interventions that elude a majority of people with Alzheimer's disease. And the impact. We heard about the global cost to our nation. Per person, it's $341,000. And this is the combined cost of Medicare, Medicaid, VA, personal out-of-pocket costs. We know families pay huge sums out-of-pocket for in-home care, for assisted living, $341,000 per person over the life course of this disease. So our work in Sacramento, starting last year, has been to focus on how we can engage the public health community, how we can mainstream Alzheimer's disease in a sense, and move away from that one-on-one individual approach to, as we've heard already, a systematic approach where we can be assured that an individual who lives in Inyo County will receive the same access and services, assessments, and a care plan as somebody who lives in Los Angeles or San Bernardino, to develop standards and systems, put systems in place. And so we find public health is the last frontier. We've worked a lot with health services over the years and the Medi-Cal programs, skilled nursing homes, hospitals. We've worked with the Department of Aging, with AAA's Area Agencies on Aging. We've worked with social services on board and care homes. We've worked with all of the departments that touch individuals with Alzheimer's disease and their families. But we've not done a lot of work with public health, and we've started that, and we've been we have found it's a learning, you know, on both ends. That what astounded me is how much is on the public health department plate. And recently, you've heard about measles outbreaks around our state. You know, public health is at the front line, and they're handling crises and emergencies and communicable diseases and border health and wildfires. So environmental health concerns, our safe drinking water. So I thought, we're going to go knock on their door with our purple ribbons, and they're going to say, come in, how can we help? And they did open the door, and they have been receptive, but with all due respect, they're not idle, just waiting around looking for things to do in public health departments. So I really appreciated that slide. It will be different in each county and in the three cities that have public health departments. Some might be very far along. Some may have done nothing with older adults. Each of them are organized differently. Some might have older adult services under their umbrella. Some might be 20 miles away from the office that handles older adults. So we took the Healthy Brain Initiative, the CDC, Centers for Disease Control, the preeminent expert, a national expert and leader, a global leader, on public health. And when they put out the Healthy Brain Initiative this fall, we thought, this is our calling card, whether it's with public health departments, physicians. It's not the Alzheimer's Association saying, here's what you can do for me. This is a collective impact effort alone. The people who put this report together were from many states, many disciplines, and they worked over many years to produce this report. And you see the bullets. The first is to educate and empower the public. And that's something we do in advocacy, to engage people who are living with Alzheimer's, family members, professionals, paraprofessionals, unpaid caregivers in this activity. To develop policies and mobilize partnerships. Something of this magnitude will not be solved by the Alzheimer's Association. It will not be solved by the public health department. There's not a governor in this country who can make this work for everyone. So we need partnerships. Workforce is a huge issue, and we'll be doing much more. And this is from, we consider workforce starting with a family member in the home who is unlicensed, unpaid, and likely untrained, all the way to a specialty neurologic surgeon with every credential under the sun, and in between, social workers, nurses, nurse practitioners, PAs. Our work focuses more on primary care now. That's new for the Alzheimer's Association. We envision a healthcare system where somebody with dementia does not have to be referred to a neurologist necessarily, that much of the detection and diagnosis can occur in a primary care setting. And here's why we have optimism today. In May, when Governor Newsom took office in January, he shared publicly, and this was a big deal because so much of Alzheimer's is still hidden and in the shadows, and there's a lot of stigma. He shared in his State of the State address that his own father had dementia and that he was an active caregiver to his father. And he shared that with all of the resources at his disposal as a national figure, financially secure, it was very difficult for his family. And he committed to funding for Alzheimer's research focused specifically on women and communities of color. And he tapped Maria Shriver to lead a prevention and preparedness task force. And he has held to that commitment. And right now, as we're meeting, he's releasing his May budget revision this morning, where we'll hear that, once again, our state is doing well financially. We're about $210 billion state budget. We're the fifth largest economy in the world. We can do more for Alzheimer's disease. And we're excited over the next 4 years to do that with Governor Newsom. We introduced a bill, AB 388. The author is Assemblymember Monique Limon. She also has a family experience with Alzheimer's disease. She is a Latina. She saw in her family the burden of Alzheimer's disease on her grandmother, her mother, and Assemblymember Limon also served as a caregiver to her grandmother. She's been working with us to raise public awareness. She believes so strongly, as we do, that more people need to be talking about Alzheimer's disease in conferences like this, in hearing rooms at the Capitol, and in community health needs assessment gatherings in our counties. So she introduced this bill for us. These are her constituents. She invited them onto the floor of the assembly, and she's working really hard for us. I'll get to that, the good part. So the goals of AB 388, the first is to increase public awareness of the signs and symptoms of dementia. It's surprising today in 2019, there's so much misinformation, false information that gets circulated. Part of raising awareness is you do see more about Alzheimer's in the news. But sometimes I'll be in legislative offices and they'll say, I thought I just read that they found the cure for that. Didn't I just see something? And I'll say, that one study that's not even phase one that involves 30 people in Omaha, Nebraska, no, that we didn't find the cure yet. So there's a lot of misinformation. And a lot of the prevention information, too, people will say, well, I heard if you just eat more dark chocolate, you can, take care of it. It's not as simple as that. So we're trying to raise factual information. And there still is a lot of, there's stigma about Alzheimer's, which as a brain condition we do, overlap a lot with some mental health conditions. There's still a lot of ageism and a sense of, well, it's not that important. They're retired or they have a family caregiver. So people don't talk about it nearly enough. So the first goal of our bill is to increase public awareness of the real signs and symptoms, to differentiate from normal aging and when you should be concerned about your cognition. The second is to improve early detection and timely diagnosis, to raise that number from 45% up to where it is with other conditions in the high 80s and 90s for most conditions. When somebody goes to the physician and says, I have crushing chest pain, the physician doesn't say, oh, we all have crushing chest pain. Talk to me about it in a year. So we want, when people say something's not right, I'm confused, or I lost my way, we want the physician to say, tell me more about that. And then the last part is to target specifically to communities that are disproportionately impacted. We had, through the work of public health, California just jumped about 25 slots. We now have the second highest longevity in the nation. Hawaii is first, California second. The average lifespan in California is now 82 years. What this means, though, is the greatest risk factor for Alzheimer's disease is age. And we know at 85, that's the highest incidence of our disease. So we want to be sure that we target our resources to individuals not only who are older, but women and communities of color who are disproportionately impacted. Communities that are underserved and underrecognized, LGBT community, rural communities. So that's a focus of our legislation as well. We talked about public awareness. You saw the slide earlier that only 16% are offered a regular cognitive assessment. It's so disappointing. There's a sentiment in the healthcare community that seniors are taken care of. They've got Medicare. They're the lucky ones. Let's focus on populations that don't have Medicare. But even with Medicare, only 16% receive a regular cognitive assessment, and that's a covered benefit. Improving detection and diagnosis, we can expect in the 80 and 90 percentiles for other conditions. We want to move Alzheimer's up those bar graphs and the targeted outreach. We do a lot of focus, and Maria Shriver will focus on women too, because not only are women at higher prevalence of the disease, women also provide the vast majority of unpaid family caregiving as daughters, wives, sisters, and women provide about 80 to 85% of the direct care, home care, in-home care, assisted living, and skilled nursing care. This is absolutely a women's disease, and this audience reflects that too. I would say we have a high number of women. So we're gonna talk with the questions. If you have further questions about what's going on in Sacramento, about the legislation AB 388, about the $10 million that it will cost. I think we can all get in our cars or however we leave here, and I bet within 1 mile of this property, there are several $10 million homes. All we're asking for is $10 million in one-time funding to fund public awareness, early detection, and targeted outreach to women and communities of color. So if you're inclined, we have a phone to action. Today's a key day because the May revise is being issued and the budget cycle sort of starts over today in our state. And we want legislators to hear that Alzheimer's is important. So we have something. If you're willing to do this, you text, I did it in reverse, so you actually text 52886 and you enter the word 10 million for alls. You'll get a prompt. We're going to take a pause so you can do it right now. A very important person named Assemblymember Phil Ting, who chairs the Budget Committee, lives right up the road from us, and we want his phone to start buzzing. So we're going to just pause while everyone who wants to do this takes action. Thank God for the Silicon Valley that we can do something like this. We used to have to collect postcards and go back to the office and enter all that data. And now, look, on our smartphones, we're able to do something in real time. So I'm going to move. Can I move to the final slide, or do people still want to see this up on the screen? No? Okay. Yep, you can text right now. Right now. So in closing, Governor Newsom's campaign slogan and what he's been focused on since arriving in Sacramento is California for all. And that's the same goal that we share. And he means all as in all parts of California, all genders, all incomes, all ethnicities, all educational backgrounds. And public health holds the promise to get into our communities to work for all. As we heard Dr. Oldham say, his patient population is now 40 million when he's working on behalf of California. And so that is our goal too, and that we really think that we can come up with some innovations, some local and custom solutions in local communities, working in partnership, in tandem with public health. So those conclude my remarks.